So welcome to Entrepreneurship Live. I'd like to thank the Herb Kelleher Center for Entrepreneurship, Growth, and Renewal and the TexTalks team for helping put this event on. We have a lot of great content like this on our website, texttalks.info. And if you, you know, like talks like these, I encourage you to go there and see what we have. You can also follow us on Twitter at TexTalks. So today we have Gaddis. She founded, she's the CEO and founder of T3. It's the largest woman-owned advertising firm in the nation, and they have over 200 employees with offices in San Francisco, New York, and Atlanta, as well as, of course, here in Austin. Yeah. So thanks so much for being with us.
Yeah, it's a pleasure. Thank you for inviting me.
Great.
And I see you've had a lot of men on your program, so I'm glad to represent a woman on stage.
Yes.
There are a few of us.
So I wanted to start at the beginning. You know, it's 1989, you have three kids, a stable job, and you decide to go out and start your own company. And, you know, what was the kind of initial idea, and what was it that gave you so much confidence that it was going to work?
Well, this was not the best time in the history of our economy. If you all, whoever in this room remembers, 87, 88, 89 was almost about as bad as 2008 and 2009. It was a very rough time. Austin and Texas was particularly challenged. Our savings and loans failed, and the real estate wasn't worth the dirt it was built on. So the agency that I was with at the time, we'd been on a growth pattern, things were going well, we'd bought a Houston office, but everything started to shrink and all the budgets were going away. So I got really kind of panicked about what was going to happen with our business. And so I was a senior partner there, but not really an owner. I wrote a business plan with some other colleagues, and I was really excited about this direction that I thought we could take the company to pull ourselves out of the recession and do a better job. I didn't think we were doing the kind of creative we should, and I didn't think we were measuring things. So the bottom line of my business plan was really the simplistic part, was that it was, we're going to do incredible, wonderful, award-winning creative, but we're going to measure everything and it has to get results. And so there was much more to it than that, but that's the simplistic form of it. So I showed it to our advisory group, and then I went in and talked to our president. And a few minutes later, after he'd read it and really looked through everything, he came to my office and he said, "Guess what? I'm not going to support your plan." And I was outraged. I was humiliated. I was mad. I really wanted to cry, but I don't cry much. So I just sat there and fumed for about 30 minutes, and then I just walked back down the hall, and I walked in and said, "I quit." And honestly, I didn't even know what I was going to do. I didn't think about it because there was no place else to get a job, really. No one was hiring anybody, and so it dawned on me that evening when I was talking to my husband that I guess I was going to have to start my own business. And what gave me confidence, though, is in, I think along in our lives that when you become competent in something, then you can gain confidence, and then you can become more assertive and have some negotiating power. What had happened is in my previous jobs, a few back, I had worked at Baylor Medical Center in Dallas and had been promoted at a very young age to the public relations director of this huge Southwest, biggest healthcare facility in the Southwest. So because of that, I had developed an expertise in healthcare marketing. And I think probably at the time, I was one of the top two people in the state who really understood that. And Mimi Drumright's back there, and she had that job before I did. So we share that in common. But what happened is I was able to bring in some accounts during this bad time that were hospital accounts around the state of Texas. And what happened when I quit was I knew those accounts were going to leave with me because no one knew as much as I did about them. And so being somewhat trying to not have a bad name in Austin, Texas back in the 80s, I negotiated a deal with the company that I was working for that I would buy the accounts from them. And it was a phased out thing over 3 years. So I walked out knowing that I had three pieces of business, but I was going to pay for them, and I had to be profitable. I only had $16,000 in my IRA, and that's how I started the company. That was how broke we were. I mean, I'd taken pay cuts. Everybody was in a bad place. And I had these three little kids, and so failure was just not an option basically. So I started off with the three healthcare accounts and then started to grow out of that. So that's how it all happened. And I don't know how I did it with the three kids, except that my mother was a saint, and she moved here from Liberty, Texas. And there's another lady out here from Liberty that she and I were in the Prancer drill team together back in high school, which I think they banned for obscenity at this point, but not really. She moved here and was an absolute saint and was not their caregiver, but was there for the pitfalls when, like, I can't get there for dinner or I'm not going to be able to pick up the kids from practice or whatever. So she was just kind of my safety net and was wonderful through all that.
Great. So to get to kind of the core of it, you know, it sounds like, well, it is, like, the philosophy was really marrying the creative with this data-driven approach, right? You wanted to measure everything. So can you kind of talk a little bit more about that, like in terms of a client? What did that mean from their perspective, and how did you, like, what was could you give an example, like, or especially early on, of a big impact that kind of philosophy had on a client that you were working with?
Yeah, I can give you one of the hospital account examples. And now you have to remember this was before the internet, or at least I didn't know about it. I think Al Gore did, but he hadn't told me about it yet. So we were literally measuring things the best we could, and most of our campaigns, though, did have an end result. One of the campaigns we ran was for King's Daughters Hospital in Temple, Texas, and we learned something through just kind of sitting in the cafes around Temple, Texas, that the Scott and White logo, S&W, stood for sit and wait. And when people went to the ER there, it was a wait, and it was a big deal. And so King's Daughters, the smaller hospital across the street, said, we can get people in and out for anything except for a major trauma. And a lot of people are sitting in the emergency room over there with, you know, a broken arm or nothing too severe, you know, and they don't need to be there. So we started a campaign that was television, outdoor, radio, print, the whole thing. And the concept behind it was the emergency room for people who don't like to be kept waiting. And it was a very clever campaign. It won Texas Hospital Awards and American Hospital Awards. But the cool thing about it was it got results, because we could see when we ran the media and we put things out there how the numbers would come straight into the ER. And so we could calculate the number of visits they had based on the cost that we were spending in the market. And then a lot of those visits would turn into inpatient stays. So then we would calculate that. So we had a really good metric around that. And those were the kinds of things we were doing back then. And then in 1992, there was a little company called Dell who called us. And shortly after that, Michael decided that he was going to sell iron on the internet. And so we didn't know how to do it, and no one else did either, but we learned how to do it together. And I'm sitting here looking at another young man whose mother was my client for probably 15 years at Dell, and we did some miraculous things together. But the internet was the thing that really was just fantastic for me, because it was the first time that we could really, truly measure things in a way that was real time. So it was a perfect medium for us to get into, and fortunately we did very early on. Most agencies didn't want to have anything to do with it, because the early internet work, if some of you remember, was very unattractive, to say the least. The color families that you could use were limited, the typefaces were clunky, and the little starbursts and all these horrible things. And so for most creative people, they didn't want to have anything to do with it. And they would walk in my office and say, don't put me on the internet stuff. I'm not doing it. And one creative director actually walked in and said, it's the CB radio of the 90s. This thing isn't going anywhere, and I'm sticking with TV and print. Okay, fine. So he didn't make it through that transition. But the internet was a big, big thing for us, because it finally opened up this door where I could see, if we do great work and we can measure it, then it all makes sense. And then I don't have to defend what we're doing. See, the worst thing for me was to fail, like I said. So if I couldn't go to a client and say, I know this is working, or at least we know this has the potential to work, then why would they keep hiring me? So I just said, we have to make it work, right?
Right, right. So that's, you know, that's a nice segue actually into, I think, obviously as a founder, you shaped the business, and especially from a personnel standpoint. So what do you see as, like, your strengths, and how did you shape the people you hired to kind of fill in what you wanted to work on and where you did, or you, what you weren't great at working on, things like that. And especially like what, at the beginning, what were your first people you were looking for?
Okay. Well, I have to go back just a little bit because my first job, I went to the University of Texas here. I was a, have a Bachelor of Fine Arts in Studio Art. In those days, though, because there were no Mac computers and all that, we had to draw everything. So my first job in the advertising business was at the Richards Group in Dallas. And I drew comps, and I could write copy and do all that stuff. But I soon figured out something was wrong with me in that job. I couldn't figure out what it was, but they, Stan Richards, put you in cubicles, and you went in, and it was a very introverted atmosphere. And I would be sitting in my cube and trying to come up with all this stuff. And one day I realized I was just brain dead. I couldn't do it, and I didn't understand why. So, you know, I failed at that job, basically. After about a year, Stan and I had a really fierce conversation and decided that he couldn't imagine why. He said, you had one of the best books I've ever seen coming out of school. I said, it's just not working for me here. I can't do it. I'm just about to go crazy. And so we parted ways. I had 2 week severance. That's how bad it was. But I ended up going to Baylor and had a great job there and did really well in media relations and PR and all that. But the next part of the story is I moved to Atlanta, Georgia. I ended up with a job. I didn't go back in the ad business. I went to a company that was run by four guys who had gotten their MBAs at Harvard together. So I started working at night, going to school, and taking all these business courses and things, working toward an MBA. But the biggest thing that I learned from these people was who I was and what I was good at and what I was not. Because it was a management consulting firm, and because of their Harvard internships, they had wonderful doors open to them at Coca-Cola, Delta, P&G, and some of the big companies at that time. And P&G wasn't in Atlanta, but that was one of their clients. So we would go in and do testing for team building and find out people's personality types and then really go into strategic planning. And I was their marketing director. So the goodness for me was I went through all those tests. And for the first time, I looked and said, well, for goodness sakes, no wonder I was so horrible at the Richards Group. I was sitting in a cube by myself. I'm a big extrovert, if you can't tell. And so my energy and everything I do comes after brainstorming with people, talking to people, and having a cool team around me. And so that became really the lessons that I took into the business when I started T3. I found people who shored up my weaknesses, because Lord knows I've got them. And so I knew what I was good at and what I wasn't. And I would find these people who could really do the things that I wasn't doing well. And then I helped them because a lot of them were introverts or they didn't really have the skill sets I did. And so I'd always try to keep this team balanced. And to this day, we still do Myers-Briggs testing at T3. I'm a big believer in it. It's not to peg a person. You know, I always say it's a zip code, not a street address. But Myers-Briggs is really, really important to me, and it's how I've built teams all these years. So, first of all, you got to hire people smarter than you, which, thank goodness, I've been able to do that. And they're all smarter than me. But I've also really looked for those skill sets that I needed. And at this point, thank goodness, in my career as CEO, I really can let go of the stuff that I don't completely, that I don't do well. Right. And every now and then I get annoyed when I have to do something that I'm not good at. Like I'm going to the TED conference in April, later in April, and I'm excited about it. It's my first big TED. I've been to TEDx and spoken at one of them. But signing up for the TED event is kind of confusing on their website, and I don't understand it. So I was just all frustrated before I got over here this afternoon going, push this, what's, you know, I said, someone do this, please. I can't even deal with it, so that's cool. Anyway, so that's what it is. It's people who do things that you don't do well, and you just appreciate that, you know. And just because they don't see things your way, that means they're showing you something that you missed.
Right.
And so I believe a whole lot in diversity across everything. Diversity of gender, diversity of ethnicity, diversity of your profile types or your personality types, and people from different parts of the world. I think it's really important because we get so stuck on just how we see things that you miss a lot. And I've really seen that to be a big driver in how we innovate.
Yeah. So you know, you grow the company from, you go from, three people at the beginning to now well over 200. And so what's that transition process like? You know, as more and more people start to you start to hire more and more people. You have less control over what is going on, you know, and like, and you move more of a managerial role, I would imagine. So, like, how do you manage that transition, or how did you manage that transition?
Well, the only way I could see that we were going to grow was for me to get out of the way sometimes. And so I tell everybody I've been fired from pretty much every job at T3. As I would get to one, then, you know, I would fire myself, basically, or someone would do it better than me, and so I'd turn it over to them. And now, at this point, you know, I say the one thing that I still do probably better than anybody is master connector. And it gives me a great thrill to be able to connect people for new business, for job opportunities, for internships, for all these things, because I've been just so fortunate over the past, really, 12 years after our youngest child went off to college, I took off. I mean, I've traveled the world. I've went everywhere meeting people and going to conferences and speaking. And so I really know a lot of people now, and they're friends. So we help each other out. And I think that's how the world works if you can do that. So it's, but my biggest thrill now is to make a connection for somebody.
Yeah.
It's fun.
Cool. Yeah. So I was reading some of what you've written, and you talked a lot about how, as an entrepreneur, one of the things you think is most important is to always be thinking about what are, like, the big pitfalls that might happen. Like, basically, think pessimistically. Say, like, what's the worst thing that could happen, and then prepare for that. So I was curious, you know, especially in those first few years when you're getting off your feet, you know, did that come in handy, that philosophy, and could you tell us a little about it?
Well, I hate to say this. I feel like I'm a very optimistic person, but my husband will tell you that if he brings forth anything, I'll come up with 10 reasons why it won't work. And it's not because I'm negative about it. It's because I like to think, I mean, I do have an analytical mind, and I like to really think through what if I could come up in, you know, 15 minutes with 10 things that won't work, then there's probably 30 things that won't work. However, if it's the right thing to do, you just push all that aside and make it work somehow. But I just like to take it apart and do that. And I don't know, I really don't think it's pessimistic. The thing that really hit me was almost 2 years ago, I was invited by the Department of Defense to accompany this program where we got to have a deep, deep look into all branches of the military. And that was one of the things that was reinforced on that trip about how that's how they have to think about things. You know, what could possibly go wrong? You plan for the disaster, and you're ready. You're prepared for it. And it's called, in PR, it's called crisis planning. You know, and that's maybe part of my training, too, that you have to look at, well, what could go wrong with this so that you're prepared and not just staying down there with your proverbial pants down when the disaster happens. So so I think it's an important way to look at things. But it's never made me not take advantage of an opportunity or pass on something that I know in my heart, because I trust my gut more than my head. And when my gut says, do it, go for it, we'll figure it out, you know.
Yeah. So, I mean, but in those first few years, was there a point, you know, where you were like, I don't know if I should have done this? Like, you know, was there any sort of inflection point? It couldn't have been smooth sailing all the way up
it's
until
not.
Now, right?
It never was. But we have these really good times, and then tough things happen, and you lose business for certain things, or but not even for your own fault. And there's just a lot of stuff that goes on after 28 years. I mean, I've been at this. So you just have to kind of step back and say, how did I get through that? You know, and I look back and I just think I had this incredible tenacity. And one of the reasons is when I was 13, my father died. And I was an only child, and both my parents thought I was just adorable. You know, I lived in a small town, and I was thrust on the stage and doing all this stuff. But I learned fairly quickly that money doesn't come easy. And my mother was a fabulous person, but she was not very good at managing finances or her money. And after my father died, we had to sell his business. And I was 14 when we did that, and I got a job right away. And through my whole life, I've always worked. And I always was afraid, no matter, you know, what was going to happen, that I had to be able to make money and take care of people. And so I was able to take care of my mother the rest of her life. She helped me a lot, you know, in return. But I've always been driven to make a profit, make money, do well. And at this point, it's not for me personally so much. I mean, I've done pretty well. And so, you know, yes, a terrible thing could happen, and I'd be penniless. But at this point in my career, it's really for my staff and for the people who work at T3. And that's what motivates me. And I think it started motivating me a long time ago because they were so wonderful and these smart people come in and they entrust their careers and their lives with you. And I owe it back to them to provide a great culture, a good place to work, and to make enough money so that we have a profit so I can continue to hire them and give them jobs and help support their families. It means a lot to me. It's the best thing I've ever done is create jobs.
Yeah. So, I mean, well, that seems to answer this question of, a lot of entrepreneurs that are lucky enough to get to the mature stage in their company look for a way to kind of cash out or exit, and you haven't done that, although I'm sure you've had many opportunities to do so. So is that, it's what you just said is basically the reason you've stuck around and hadn't sold part of the business?
Yeah, this company was never built to sell, and a lot of companies are. That's the goal. My youngest son started a company here in Austin a few years ago, and the whole objective was to eventually sell it. But this company was always kind of like my baby in a way, and you don't sell your children very often, I hope. Well, some people do, and that's a horrible story that we won't go into. But it was really something that I had my heart and soul in, and we have been approached numerous times to be purchased. We're a hot commodity out there. We're one of the last big digital oriented, although we do other things, but T3 has been, we're number five, or in the top five, of Forrester's most innovative agencies in the country. And so it's a little T3 independent, yeah. Pretty exciting. So, thank you. And so because of that, I didn't really ever want to sell the business, but I've been fortunate because a lot of people have to sell their business at some point to get the equity out of the company. And knock on wood, I don't know if that's real, maybe it is. No, it's not a picture of wood. But I have managed, with the help of my team, to make a profit every year that we've been in business. So along the way, I've taken some money along the way. So it's not like I'm looking for this big windfall someday to get my money back so I can retire. It's not necessary. And the other thing that's been just amazingly miraculous is that our oldest son, Ben, really loves the business. And he thought when he was at A&M he was going to waltz right back in to T3 after graduating and have a spot at the company. And I informed him that he was not going to come. I remember we were having lunch at Ranch 616. That was also when he announced to me that he was on the 5-year plan. Isn't that going to be fun? And I said, no, you're not. I said, you may be on the 5-year plan, but after 4 years, I quit paying. So if you want to pay the rest of it and take out loans and do that, you just go ahead and do it. I said, so you're either out in 4 years or have fun. Go raise your own money. So, and I did do a little thing. I told him that if he got out on time, I would write him a check for $10,000, which I ended up doing because he went back and I said, how many hours do you have left to graduate? He said, I have no idea. I said, are you kidding me? I said, you're a first semester junior. You go back and you tell me exactly how many hours you have. And I said, you can do this. So he did. And so long story short, he did not come to T3. I said, you go out and you figure out if you love this business. And so he had several different jobs, and the last one, he was at Timberland McLean, he worked at Richards Group, and the last job he had was with a very progressive mobile company that no one thought mobile was, this was like 9 years ago, no one thought mobile was going to be as big as it has become. And so I was worried if he went to that job that he would get pigeonholed as the mobile guy and not have a very well-rounded experience if he did come back to the company. But it turned out to be the best thing ever because when he came back almost 8 years ago, or 7 years ago now, he had a real expertise that we jumped on and made mobile a key part of what we were doing. So that was all good. But we've been approached to be purchased, and one of the saddest stories of all, I think Zach probably knows this one, is that we had been at Dell for 16 years and made it through all these different agencies, and we were kind of like the little engine that could and stayed out there all those years while other things changed. And in 2008, they decided to bring in, or 2007-8, they brought in a new CMO and his second in command, and their objective was to create one agency for Dell. and they were named it Infatico, and WPP, which is a large holding company, was going to put this together. So we found out after all this was starting to happen that they said, you're the only thing not broken, you're staying. But the only way we could stay is if we sold to WPP. And I had a horrible meeting with one of the guys on February the 14th, 2008. I called it the St. Valentine's Day Massacre because they came in and gave me an ultimatum that if I didn't sell, that we were going to have to leave. And so we took our three-month out clause, and it was one of the most painful things and horrible things I've ever been through in my life. Because at that point, we were doing all the small, medium business for Dell. It was $70 million in revenue for us. That was huge. And we walked away from it that day. But I had to stick to my guns. You know, and everyone on the team understood it. It was a very, very difficult time. But I went out and sold around it. You know, I sold and sold and sold. I called everybody I'd ever known in the business and said, I've got this wonderful team here. And we managed to get over it. And we still made a profit at the end of the year. I can't believe it now. But that was, I've never worked so hard in my life. Wow. But I was very motivated because I didn't want the ship to go down over that.
Right. Wow, that's, yeah. So we talked about, you mentioned mobile and digital. So, you know, your philosophy anticipated the internet in a way, right? Like you were before it came along, but the data-driven approach. Mm-hmm. So what was the trends? I mean, it seems like you have to stay on the cutting edge of the next hot thing in the industry that you're in. So I'm curious, like, how you manage those transitions, because there's been several of them over the course of the company. I mean, more than several, but... just huge trends that come along that you have to adapt quickly to.
We've always looked ahead, and I think that's been the real hallmark of T3, and probably why we're an innovation agency, because the people recognize how we've done this. It's not just a body of work for 6 months. It's been a trajectory for us all these years.
How do you spot like what you see? Yeah, like what do you see is gonna be the next thing?
You know, this is interesting. I gave a speech at UPS yesterday, and they said, what inspires your work? What drives your work? And I said, it's our client's customer. That's who it is. Because, I mean, there's a lot of things out there that could inspire great creative. But we watch what the customers do, and we've always done this. And if they're doing something like this, we better be in this device. Or if they are, you know, if they were the first time when we started to see social media becoming a potential, we were one of the first companies in the country who took a big brand on Facebook, of all things. JCPenney was on Facebook. We did chats with Cindy Crawford way back in the day, you know, and we always experimented with that because we felt like there were other ways to get to that customer. And if a customer trend was starting to move a little bit in a direction, then we wanted to be there and we wanted to figure it out. So, I mean, that's the simplest way to tell you, although I do have people who are always thinking ahead. I mean, that's what they do. That's their job. And we have an innovation team, but that's not just exclusive to them. I mean, everybody on the team's thinking of this. So you get your client work done, but you also are starting to say, well, how could we do something better or show the client something that no one else is showing them. I remember there's a little company that sells yellow and green tractors. You may know who that might be. They were a client many years ago, and we saw a trend before anyone was really watching social media that much, that they were one of the most beloved brands in the country. People love John Deere. And we were seeing it back in those days in Flickr and some of the old, you know, social ways that people were sharing stuff. And so we went and we said, guess what? You've got to do this. So we're going to do this control center. It's going to be like the old media room, like a newsroom. And we'll put someone in the center, and then all these people will be watching and seeing what all these people are doing. And we're going to, you know, expand it and just blow it up so that you really get all the goodness out of this. And you would have thought I had dropped a bomb in the middle of their thing. No way. We can't control that. You know, and they were terrified that if they let their brand, anyone talk about them and they were involved in it, they would be responsible for all these responses. And remember when all that was going on? And so I look back on that now, though, and say if they had done that then, they wouldn't have had a competitor left. I mean, they could have just owned it outright because they had so much goodness. So, but the reason I tell that story is that a lot of times we've gone out and almost scared clients or been too far ahead of them. because we see what's going to happen sometimes. Sometimes we're not right, but we certainly are looking. And the bold and brave ones have let us do some of this crazy stuff. And going back to Dell, I mean, I tell the bad story about the end, but that was a fantastic experience for us because, especially in the earlier days of Dell, it was get 80% right and don't worry about the 20%. Let's just go, 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 you know. And we knew how to make money on the internet, and it was just experimenting all the time, fast run and gun, and it was really, really good for us to be a part of that kind of environment.
So, Austin, you know, you've founded the business here, and so what's it been like to see that change over the last, you know, 26 years, I guess?
Well, I date myself because I have lived in Austin off and on since 1974. That's when I got to school here. And can you believe, I mean, SIDS was, did you remember SIDS, that place where the post office is on Lamar? It was one of the only diners, and there was like the Nighthawk, and, you know, I think Tapatio. We had no restaurants here. There's no traffic. It was kind of a sleepy town, and there's nothing going on much except for what was going on at UT, which was about the biggest thing going, and of course the state government. But other than that, there was just a few small businesses, and then here came IBM though in 1962 and put a foothold here, which changed the game forever. And then you had Motorola and 3M, and all these companies came. But the interesting thing about them is that none of them were headquartered here. So you still had the small businesses here in Austin. And so when Dell put, you know, their roots here and started the business here, it was really one of the only pieces of business that you could get here that was an Austin company that was headquartered here, where decisions were made here. And so it was our only big Austin client for years. So I used to have to apologize to people. We were pitching business all over the place early on, and we had a national cable company back in the in 1990, and doing winning ESPN's first awards and all that stuff. But I would apologize when I'd go out. And I'd say, I know we're from Austin, Texas, but I promise you, we've got people with experience from all over. It's a great town, and we won't let you down. And so we had to work on smaller regional stuff and all that. But it kind of grew into bigger, bigger things. And now the reverse is happening. Everybody wants to come here. So clients will go do anything to come here. We have 16 people. There's Sean back there. I think he'll be there from T3. But we have 16 or 17 people coming from Capital One to our ranch because they want to come to Austin and they want to come there. And South by Southwest was a big success because all of our clients want to come here. But it sure wasn't that way back in 1989.
Yeah.
No one had even heard of it. And we couldn't believe they didn't love the Texas Longhorns. I mean, my goodness. No.
So we talked, so you were mentioned how, you know, one of the things you have to do is be looking ahead constantly and be ready to innovate. So I was curious what your kind of thoughts are on the next 5 years for T3 and like, what are the trends you guys see coming up?
Well, I don't know if it's five, I don't know if I can get out as far as five, but I can tell you right now what's exciting to us. We don't quit the blocking and tackling we do. I mean, we still do that, but I think mobile will continue to be just explode, you know, and you've got the entire world connected with that now,
right?
Even in developing countries. But we're pretty fired up about artificial intelligence, and we've just been working with IBM Watson on two or three really cool projects. One is for Staples. It's going to take the easy button and make it really function and not just a little toy. And so we've been working with really kind of having a good time with the engineers at IBM working on some new things. We've already experimented a good bit with virtual reality. I don't know how fast that's going to take off, but we're seeing some ways that we think it can be really useful. And so I say the word useful because our brand studies that we've done and funded over the past couple of years is all about the useful brand. And we believe that brands have to be useful first or they really aren't worth much. So yeah, it has to have a connection and you got to believe in it. But brands that really are useful to you, you will stay with, you'll be loyal to. Those that are annoying or that don't really provide any utility for you or some goodness in your life, you don't want to have anything to do with them. So we're really excited about kind of studying that. And when I teach at UT sometimes, I say, guess what one of the most useful brands is? Do you all know? Can anyone guess what one useful brand might be? Kleenex is one of them, absolutely, and Band-Aids. But there's a bunch of others, and we rate all of them, you know, on a scale, and we talk to our clients about it, and we can tell some things that we can do with different age cohorts and different ways that we can move the needle to make them more useful and not just another brand. So there's that. I think that as far as what we're going to do, again, it's going to be where the customers go, but there's going to be, I think we're going to see just some tremendous things out of what Watson's doing. You know, we're going to cure diseases. We're going to have all kinds of wild stuff. So we just want to be right in there with that. Our software engineers are brilliant. We did a project recently in what we call a rapid prototyping mode, which we do a lot. And I think that's how we get to the new or what's next. You just throw something in and see if they can make it happen. So if you go to our website, I think it's still up, we did a little thing that was pretty funny. One of our team members in New York said, you know what, have you all noticed that every time Trump tweets about a company, the stock goes up and down like this based on what he says? And we went, yeah, what if we could capture that same way? So we threw it to the dev guys and the software engineers, and they came up with this bot that in nanoseconds can trace the tweet and go right in and either buy a stock or sell it short. And so we did it in 5 days. We prototyped this and made it work. So we call it the Dump Trump bot. And it's nothing political. It has nothing to do with whether or not you agree with Trump or not. It was just the idea that we could do this. And so we've actually made money off doing this, and we donate all the money to the ASPCA to save a puppy. So anyway, but again, those are the kind of things that we are doing all the time. You know, when someone comes up with an idea, we just put it into testing and see if we can do it. And the other thing I'm real proud about that we're just really kicking off in a big way are loyalty programs. And we've done some of the biggest ones in the country. We just launched a huge one for Pizza Hut. And so there's a lot of moving pieces that go with that. But yeah, that's kind of a different piece of the business than we've been in the past. So we never say no. I always laughed, you know, I keep looking at Zach because of Dell over here. But for 16 years, Dell would come in and say, can you do this? And I'd always say, sure, we could do that. We didn't know if we could or not, but we never said no. We figured it out. And so that's kind of our mentality. It's like, yeah, we can do that and see what happens, and we'll make it better if it doesn't work. But it's a curiosity around what's next and what you can do.
Yeah, very cool. So I would be remiss, given all the recent news, you know, diversity in tech, and without asking you, you know, what are your thoughts on kind of how women are doing in the workforce now? And
well, what a great segue. I'm writing a book. The book will come out in January of 2018. And I'll tell you the name of it. It's Cowgirl Power. It has another subhead with it. What I'm really seeing is that women are doing a lot better than what our media, be it male and female, is leading us to believe. Because what the media tells us is it's a numbers game. Well, there's 25 male CEOs that will be at this event and only two female. Or, you know, we have this many corporate board members that are men, but no women are really succeeding there. And they play these number games with us all the time. And so if you read the news every day and you're a woman, you start to get pretty depressed thinking, well, we're not making any progress. And that's what the rhetoric is out there. Well, you know, we haven't made much progress in 20 years. So I started digging down in this, in the research of my book, and I realized that intuitively, we've done this in T3 from the beginning. I have senior women who run all of our accounts. Okay, they are great at running teams. And I see women leading and contributing in big ways to high-performing teams. And in an innovation society, teams is where the innovation comes from. It's not, doesn't come from the top down. It's not these silos of people. It's these high-performing, high-functioning teams that have to be glued together. They have to trust each other. They have to be willing to prototype, willing to make mistakes. And every time I look at them, I mean, I certainly have wonderful men who are in these teams or who lead them. But women are doing really well there. And so I think we need to quit beating ourselves up about all this stuff. So in the book, it talks a little bit about that, and it's also just about how you find your personal power and some of the lessons I've learned along the way and how I did it. But yeah, I think women are doing a lot better than we get credit for. And so don't let anyone tell you we're not doing well. And there are certainly a lot of women who've taken, you know, the CEO path, and I've got a lot of friends who've taken a beating. You know, it's really hard to be in these publicly traded companies, though. One case in point is a very dear friend of mine, Ellen Kuhlman, who was the CEO and chairman of DuPont, who worked there her entire career. And then she had a hostile takeover on the board, which a lot of companies have had. And, you know, she won the battle to begin with, and then it just collapsed again. So she ended up having to leave, which was a terrible thing. But I start thinking about it. You know, if you want to run bell to bell, quarter to quarter, only worrying about stock prices, that's kind of a rough life, you know, and dealing with boards, directors, and all that. I think women don't really necessarily want to do that. I mean, I'm glad I don't have to, and that's one of the reasons I didn't want to sell the company, because I don't want to worry about somebody's stock and all that. I mean, I serve on a publicly traded board, and I watch what we have to, the compliance and all the things we have to do, and sometimes how it wastes a lot of time, to be honest, you know, just getting ready for these meetings and these shareholder meetings, all that stuff. My God, we could have done 200 new things by the man hours and woman hours it has taken to prepare for this stuff. So it's tough. It's a tough job.
Yeah. Well, I have one more question, but afterwards, if any of you have questions, I encourage you to come up and ask them. So given that you mentioned that you're writing a book, I'd be curious about book recommendations. So we ask most of our guests, if you have one business book and one non-business book that you could recommend to our audience, what would
they
be? Okay.
Well, this one is old, but I always recommend this, and it's because it helped me. It's a really old book. I guess it's still in print, but it's called Fierce Conversations. And it came to me at a time that I needed to change some folks at T3. What happens is a lot of people, and I've been so fortunate, have made it through the years. I mean, I have people who've been there 20-some-odd years, and they can, you know, make the changes and go with you the whole way. But some people are really, they're not in it for that. You know, it's not their skill set anymore, and sometimes you have to coach them out of the business, and it is a tough thing to do. So that book really helped me. It really helped me that I felt like I was really not hurting them so much as I was just letting us have an open dialogue to reach the same conclusion, basically, because people usually know when they're not hitting it, you know, but it's hard to admit. So I did that. And then I think one of the most interesting books, and it's not brand new either, is Operation Mincemeat. I don't know if any of you have read this, but it's about World War II, and Ian Fleming was in the Special Services, and so he wrote James Bond, and he was really in this. And so they created one of the most extraordinary ruses in the entire war, where they put a dead man's body out off the coast of Italy and literally tricked the Germans into thinking that he was a real British, you know, officer, and potentially, and in the claims are that it probably changed the war, because it threw off everything as far as where the U.S. and Normandy and all the things were going to be. So anyway, it's a great book. It's kind of tedious, but it's down the weeds of all the little things they did, but it's really cool. So I just loved it.
Great. Well, thanks so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Josh.
If anybody has questions, now would be the time to ask. We're going to have a reception afterwards, a short reception, so if any of you all would like the chance to speak with Gay, feel free to join us.
And I love Q&A. I answer everything. I'm not afraid of it at all. Yes?
Where did you get the name T3?
Okay, I'm glad you asked that. Sometimes I forget because, you know, when it's your own name, you forget this. Actually, when I started the company, it was not T3. It was called Warren Martino, and my maiden name is Warren, and so I used that because my dad had a company before he passed away. It was Warren Engineering, and then there was a creative director named David Martino who worked with me. So we were the two, you know, principals in the agency at the time, so it was Warren Martino, but we started calling ourselves the think tank all the time because we didn't want to be known as another ad agency. So that was part of our positioning. And so my husband always teased me, and he said, well, what are you going to do with this little ad agency? And finally, I got mad at him one night, and I said, we're going to do kick-ass work for clients who want to kick-ass. And that became still framed in the front of our building. But the whole thing was we wanted to be a think tank. And the reason was I didn't believe that all the ideas were born inside the agency. I thought we need to bring in consultants, experts from different industries, freelancers, whatever, and then we'd have these think tank sessions and come up with all these ideas and stuff to go to show the clients. And sometimes they were ideas they didn't even ask for, and that's why we've always kind of stayed ahead of this. So T3 then, a few years into it, we took the names off the door and just called it T3, standing for the think tank, TTT.
So you mentioned that one of the most valuable things about a brand is whether it's useful or not.
Yeah.
So what was an example of a brand that you worked with that was really difficult to make useful?
Well, I don't want to call names on that, but you know, you kind of look at some of the car companies that have not been so useful. And that I can tell you about that a little bit. but you know, really, almost all of our clients could be better at it. And so that's what I was saying. We're really trying to dig down into how we can change those numbers a little bit. And you look at what I was saying, too, about the ages. So some brands are very useful for, like Amazon is wildly useful for people, you know, in like 45 to 70. And not as much. It's getting more for the younger folks. But it's like all these things, it could be very useful for a different age group and not so much for another. And so we try to look at it in some of the hotel brands and things we've worked on and said, you know, how can you become more useful to that next group up or down? And what is it going to take? So sometimes they can be, but Band-Aids are ubiquitous. Everybody likes a Band-Aid and a Kleenex. We all use it. Okay, it's really kind of what I was talking about with what we do. You need to really be thinking about, not of course the look and feel and everything is going to always be important and being on brand and being clever and whatever, but I think it's really studying the business that you're working for, not only the industry and understanding the competitive forces and what everyone's doing, but I expect when we have people working on a piece of business, I want them to know that business inside and out. And I want to know when the stock's down. I want them to know, you know, if they're having issues or if they have union issues, whatever it is, and what's good that's happening there. So that our ideas are not just typical ad agency creative ideas. They are also very thoughtful about understanding where our clients are. And they live in political, tough worlds every day. And we have to get our head around that, so that we can really work with them and break down some of the barriers so that they can be open to thinking and not so plagued by sometimes just the politics. It's tough. So I just ask the creatives to think more like business people sometimes. And that doesn't mean that you don't have to be really, really great at your craft, you know. And certainly we have people who are just do beautiful work, you know. I have Sean out here who's designing my book cover. Yay. And that's tough to do because Hachette bought my book, and I found out very early on that they're heavy-handed and all the publishers are with the book cover design. And so they sent a design down to us that we weren't too happy about. And fortunately, Sean and team have been working on some things, and I presented his ideas to them, and we all decided there was one that was definitely the best. So that's good. So, again, you have to be really great at your craft, you know, and know the aesthetics of everything, but mainly it's just kind of getting your head around the business of it all, knowing where money's made. You know, I always tell everybody the biggest success you can be is you learn where the money's made, where you're working, and who you're working with, and they'll set you apart from other creatives because a lot of them don't necessarily do that.
Sure. Okay. So I had a question. You've obviously spent a lot of time with several different teams, and you've also built several teams in your years. So I was wondering what you found to be the most important when you build these teams. What's important to build in building optimal and optimally effective teams, and teams that last? So what makes a successful team, basically, in your eyes, in terms of leading them, building them, and like managing them over years.
Okay. Well, I'm not, I don't want to overemphasize this, but I do think diversity of all types is very important. If you get too many people that are alike in whatever way, you miss so much and you just don't see it. And so for me, it was always exciting to kind of be a cheerleader to them in a way and encouraging them to go do these things and not micromanage people. I've been able to delegate things pretty well through the years. The other thing about teams is, you know, you've got to match sometimes the team to the task. And there are going to be certain kinds of people who are going to do better. You know, just think about it. Who was better to work on our Dell business than not? It had to be people who really liked marketing technology and really had their head around it. I had people who worked on the JCPenney business for years who were really kind of into fashion and understood all that stuff. And so you try to match not only the personality, the type of work they're doing, but just really kind of what they are really passionate about. And then they do a much better job for the client because that's something they're into anyway, you know. But then I've seen people move around. It's really good. You know, you can move into different things and get your skills and learning over to other areas. But that always works the best. You just find people, God, I'd love to work on that piece of business, you know. And then you put the people around them that makes them work and the other and all that. So. And I've done this through the years. You just kind of continue to build teams. And we're all about teams. I mean, that's how all this work gets done. So.
Right here.
Thank you very much. I'm wondering if about the concept of neuromarketing. Does neuromarketing play any, does it play any role in your agency?
Neuromarketing?
Yes.
I don't even know what that is.
Marketing to understanding the strengths of the brain and what we like and don't like from almost a subconscious perspective. And like, for example, McDonald's used the color yellow because it causes us to, our blood pressure to increase and to get in and out very quickly. So they used that for their fast food. That's like a neural marketing.
You know, this is some, well, I totally appreciate what you're saying. We don't really use that term that much, but or at all, I haven't. But we certainly look at motivators and what those triggers are and what people are, you know, what motivates them to do things. And so all that kind of comes into play, everything from color to smells to their experience in the store, you know, it's all that. So a lot of times what we'll do, especially but for 7-Eleven example, we would map a person's experience in the retail facility and kind of start to watch customers. So we really watch customers, and there's all those behavioral things come into it. So I guess we are doing that. But I've never really called it that per se, but I don't know. Whereas, do we call it that all the time? So just your term is a little off to me.
Right here? Yeah.
Hi, thank you. I would love to hear how you have managed a work-life balance as a wife and mother.
Well, it's been tough.
Even if it's one piece of the puzzle.
Yeah, it's tough. And I honestly don't think, I think it's a fantasy to even use that term. There is really not a balance. It goes like this and like this and like this. So sometimes it's your family because it is. And then other times your work is so intense that takes precedence. So I always tried to kind of, at the end of it, you know, make some sense and not just completely be all about work. But sometimes that's what it was. And sometimes my family really needed me and I was there for them and I was able to negotiate time to be with them because I came from a position of making money for the company I was working for or my own. I could do what I wanted to. That gave me a lot of freedom, actually, you know, being my entrepreneur. But the thing that I think I always tell everybody is that when you have children, when you're with them, you have to really be all in. And I think it's more challenging now than it's ever been because when you think of when my children were younger, the only way anyone could get to me was a landline and then some email. But there was no, we didn't really have all the technology and the connectivity and all the things we do today, which distracts you and it's very easy to get off. So when I was with my kids, I was really with them. You know, I was there to read the books and do all the stuff. And I was, you know, we had a lot of fun. But my daughter one time surprised me. We were in Beijing, and I was giving a speech. And so there's all these people out in the audience. And so I introduced her at the beginning of the speech. And I said, oh, and my daughter Rebecca is here with me. I'm so glad she could accompany me. So the first question that came from the audience was not to me, to her. And this woman stood up, and she said, well, what was it like having a mother like her? I had no idea what she was going to say. I never asked her, and I had never heard her answer this. So she said, yeah, there were times my mom wasn't there, and it made me sad. And she said, but when she was with me, she was all there, all with me, and I knew she always loved me. And so I started crying, you know. But that's what I tried to do. And I think women especially beat up on themselves too much over it. You know, it's just too much. You have to do the best you can, you know. And if you have to throw them in the pizza buffet line some night, now my kids are health freaks. I mean, they eat the healthiest food, but I have to admit, I'd pile them in the Suburban and drive through McDonald's and the pizza buffet because I had to eat something. I at least fed them, right? That was good. You've been waiting way back.
Well, you mentioned like earlier on in the conversation that you had a lot of connections, you made connections worldwide. What is your piece of advice of how to maintain those relationships and connections so that you can accurately connect people and just maintain them?
It's a lot of work, I'll tell you. One of the things that I like to do is if I think of somebody, I just pop them an email, you know, or I'll call them or, you know, send them a handwritten note. I do a lot of handwritten notes. Or if something happens in their life and I know about it, I try to congratulate them. Or a very dear friend of mine's husband died recently. She was the first female producer at NBC. And then she started the Food Network, and her name's Judy Girard. And so I knew she's probably going through a lot of pain. And so I sent a donation to the place that he wanted, and I wrote her a really long note. And she got back to me, and she said it just meant so much. So it's little stuff like that. I mean, that's not little. That was a big deal. But, you know, it's all kinds of things. And I try to keep up with people's kids, and, you know, and it's just it takes a lot of work. It's all I can say, you know. But the people who are really important to you and that you've had exchanged a valuable relationship with are very much worth keeping in touch with, I think. And you never know when they're going to come back in your life. I ran into somebody yesterday Monday on the plane that I hadn't seen in a while, but it was a real key to our success at Chase Bank, and I just thanked him, and he said, let's get together. I said, okay. So it's all, you know, just always kind of looking around for people and paying attention to who's in the room with you and taking the time. It's worth it, I think.
I have a question. Back to that, the teams, and I was thinking about you and your cubicle. What does your workspace look like? Is everybody kind of together? How does that work?
You know, it's really evolved through the years. But when we first started the company, we were all kind of out. I only had 1,000 square feet, so there weren't too many places to hide. But we were all together. And then through the years, we kind of got into some office stuff and different things happened. But I always believed in people talking to each other. And so I don't know if you all know this, but for many years, we officed on Rio Grande Street and West Avenue in some historical mansions. And fortunately, I was able to keep those through the recession. And so we lease those out now. But they became counterproductive because as much as I loved those fabulous old homes, people got in their houses. And you wouldn't see someone else in the other house for 2 weeks sometimes, or at a staff meeting. And so they all had their own coffee pots and their own teams and their own stuff, and they were like little, you know, tribes. So the objective in moving to the property at MLK and Lamar, which was the originally Texas Medical Association building, was to open it up, just open the whole thing up. And so today, if you walk into T3, you see people looking at each other, all sitting together. It's very open and lots of meeting spaces, think tank rooms where they can go off and really think and work on ideas. But it's very collaborative. And I think that's just the way things are working these days. It just makes more sense.
I think we have time for one more.
One more. I'll let you all escape.
Sure. So, I think that you mentioned earlier that you guys have a New York office as well. Is that true? Mm-hmm. I was just curious how you've thought about ensuring continuity of culture and teams working out of different locations. I know there's a lot of technology that enables that, but is there any tips you would offer in sort of making sure that operating out of multiple locations with a global business goes smoothly?
I think there's several reasons why this works for us. First of all, we have one P&L across the entire company. So there's no one pitted against anyone else. So the whole team, we all rise or we all fall. So, and because of this, you have talent in some of these other markets that don't want to be in Austin or that we can't get here. And so we put them together on teams, and we travel a good bit. They see each other face-to-face as much as possible. But there is a lot of, you know, a lot of phone calls, a lot of, you know, Skyping, a lot of, you know, video conferencing and all that. But I was really pleased. I'm glad you asked this, because I was having dinner with the Atlanta team last night. And it's a growing group for T3. We've got 10 folks here now and growing. And they all told me that they were really excited because they felt like they were really part of T3 and the culture. And that everyone in Austin, especially, because this is where the most are, you know, here, had really made it very, very, gone out of their way to make that happen. And so I couldn't have told you that, but they told me. And so we have great talent in San Francisco that never going to come here, you know. But we get them all working on different businesses together, and so they're not just in their little office working on their account. They all work together, and we draw on that talent, you know, as we need to. So that's where it's worked pretty well. It's not perfect, but it's worked pretty well.
Well, great. Well, thanks again for coming. Appreciate it.